The truth of California Indians has never been told. It's never been told by the Catholic Church. It's never been told by Spain, by Mexico, by the state of California, by the U.S. government. The truth has never been told regarding our history.
On September 23rd, 2015, a Franciscan missionary named Junipero Serra was canonized or sainted by Pope Francis in spite of the angry protest of Native Americans all across the United States.
Father Serra was the person who started the California missions, and he did not treat the Native people in the missions well at all. And so when Pope Francis decided to canonize him, and I believe it had been a process that had been worked on for many years by certain people in the United States, but when Pope Francis said that he would canonize Serra, that was like stabbing a huge, huge knife into people.
Junipero Serra, founder of the first nine Spanish missions in California, has been dead for more than 230 years. But in recent times, he became a lightning rod for Native peoples, fed up with the glorification of historical European explorers, exploiters, colonizers, and settlers. For them, Serra was and still is a symbol of the centuries of slavery, genocide, and culturicide brought to indigenous peoples by European Christians in their quest for lands, resources, and worldwide domination. If you've ever driven down California's Highway 101, you may have noticed the historical bell markers that appear every mile or two along the way. Attached to some of those markers are signs that say Historic El Camino Real. There are about 600 of those bells maintained by the California Department of Transportation, Caltrans, which is funded by California taxpayers. What most people don't know is that California's Camino Real was a hoax, part of an elaborate myth created by a generation of land developers, tourism boosters, and fanciful writers to bring people and their money to the young state. Beginning around 1880, this myth glorified the missions and the Padres while denigrating and demonizing Native peoples. That myth was eventually accepted as historical fact, touted in magazines, books, and films, inserted into public schools, and taught to generations of California students. The mission myth, or hoax, evolved over a period of time and came to consist of four main parts. Number one, California Indians were part of the most worthless race of people on the face of the earth who had to be saved and civilized at any cost. They had no culture, religion, values, or real language of their own. Number two, under the heroic leadership of Father Serra, the courageous and selfless Spanish Franciscan friars successfully converted and civilized the lazy, dishonest Indians of California, who became willing and happy workers within the mission system. Number three, the 21 missions were built in sequence from south to north, beginning in San Diego and ending in Sonoma. They were constructed a single day's journey apart in order to provide a comfortable way station for any non-Indian traveler that might pass that way. They were connected by a road built under Serra's supervision called El Camino Real, or the Royal Road. Number four, California Mission Indians loved the priest who treated the natives only with kindness. Any discomfort or loss of Native life was due to the inferior qualities of the Indians themselves. Only serious lawbreakers were ever punished. What you are about to hear and see are historical truths, truths told by dedicated researchers and authors and by descendants of the Native peoples who experienced that history. For some people, this truth can hurt, but for others, it can heal.
When Junipero Serra came to California, he was not following the footsteps of Jesus Christ. A lot of people think that when he came here, he was an evangelizer, and he was following the footsteps of Jesus Christ. That could be that's the furthest thing from the truth. Whenever Jesus Christ evangelized, he did not take soldiers with him.
California Mission founder Father Serra had previously been an officer of the Spanish Inquisition and believed in physical punishment for those who did not adhere to the church doctrines and practices. He also believed and practiced physical punishments for impure thoughts or acts. Self-flagellation was part of his own personal routine. These attitudes were evident in his prescription for converting and civilizing indigenous peoples.
He was an agent of the Inquisition when he was in Mexico. So he thought, obviously, that the Inquisition was worthwhile, that it was doing its job. So that was in the back of his mind, and you combine that with his fanaticism. And everything he tried to do was beating himself, whipping himself, and wearing what they call mail across his chest and stomach, and that had spikes about this long or maybe about that long, and would cinch that up tightly. And then he would have another one that was cinched around his thighs, or maybe both of them, cinched up very tightly so that those barbs would penetrate. He also used to burn himself with a torch. He'd take the torch while he was saying sermons during his time in Mexico City, and then hold a burning torch against his chest and just then pull it off along with the charred skin. So that was just horrible what he did to himself.
That spiritual fathers should punish their sons, the Indians, with blows appears to be as old as the conquest of the Americas. Two or three whippings applied to them may serve, for them and for the rest, as a warning of spiritual benefit for them all.
According to Father Matthew Elshoff of Mission Santa Ynez, the Franciscans didn't send their best priests to the Americas as missionaries. They sent problem priests to faraway outposts so they couldn't do damage in their home communities, as was a common Catholic clergy practice. When thinking about the 21 missions established by Spain in Alta California, you have to realize they weren't anything like Christian missions you think of today. Actually, the Spanish missions were intended to do much more than merely Christianize the Indians. They were, in fact, outposts of the Spanish colonial empire, and the Indians merely the labor force needed to build and maintain those outposts.
It would be a good idea to imagine if we had a time machine. So we go to the mission like here in Santa Barbara today. Everything is climate controlled, the gardens are beautiful, the statues are beautiful, the museums emphasize the religious aspect of the missions, but we don't see anything about the reality of what happened. If we could get into a time machine, and that would bring us back to all of a sudden, poof, we're here in 1778 or whatever it was, when the missions started moving, we would see something very sad.
Indigenous people entered the mission community, they were first asked to repeat a statement that declared their belief in a strange religious system made in a foreign language they didn't understand. Once that formality was out of the way, the padres baptized the neophytes, as they were called, gave them Spanish Catholic names, and entered them in the baptismal book. Depending on their age and gender, neophytes were divided into three groups. One, married couples with children under age 10. Two, unmarried females 10 years old and up. And three, unmarried males 10 years old and up. Each group slept in separate, well-supervised quarters. Of course, there were rules to be followed in this new religious life. You had to learn to understand and speak a foreign language. No heathen languages were allowed. No heathen religious activities either. You had to hear the words of the Black Book every day, even if you didn't understand what was being read. Most importantly, You must not interact with the unmarried members of the opposite sex, and you must follow the daily schedule and perform your work duties as assigned. Daily life within a California mission was ruled by the bells. First morning bells signaled time for morning prayers while kneeling. The second bell signaled time for breakfast, made up of food you've never seen, food that will make you sick to your stomach. You must learn to like it, for that is all there is to eat. The third bell signaled time for work. Men and boys 10 and up made adobe bricks or plowed the fields or did a dozen other manual labor jobs. Women and girls 10 and older scrubbed floors, made clothes, prepared food, or did a dozen other manual labor jobs. The next bell signaled time for another gut-wrenching meal. Finally, time came for an afternoon rest. Then another bell signaled time for reading from the black book, even though you can't understand what's being said. Final bell, time for your separate beds. Ding dong, day in, day out. Any Indian who does not understand what's being said or who breaks the rules or doesn't do their jobs will be disciplined as instructed by our Padre Presidente, Father Serra. In a letter to the commander of California's colonial soldiers, Serra wrote,
"If your lordship does not have shackles with your permission, they may be sent from here. I think that punishment should last 1 month."
So allow me to introduce you to the tools of discipline. For the smallest infractions, like not paying attention during worship or Bible readings, there's the cane. With this, the padre can reach across other worshipers to whack you across the back or head. Then we have the cudgel for quick corrections in any situation. For any of you who try to run away, we have several means of preventing any further attempts, such as leg irons and various forms of hobbles and shackles. For any unmarried woman who misbehaves with a man, we have these ankle stocks to take care of that temptation. The great thing about shackles and hobbles is that they still allow you to get your work done. The whip is another instrument of correction, which creates that painful spark towards repentance. But for those who tend to break the rules over and over again, there's a cat of nine tails. In extreme cases, each of the nine whips can be equipped with barbs that leave a long-lasting impression. The King of Spain has ordered that you neophytes can only be trained in the ways of civilization and religion for 10 years, and then you must be allowed to return to your home communities. But the king doesn't understand what you Indians are really like, so you will be staying here at the mission for the rest of your life to work for us without pay. And when you die from the filth, disease, malnutrition, or physical abuse, we'll just go out and round up more souls who need saving.
The problem is with the Franciscans of that period is that they were part of the apparatus of the conquest. So it was the cross and the crown. Don't forget, the key word was domination. The friars and the soldiers dominated the Indians. They destroyed their religion. They destroyed their relationship to the land. They destroyed their culture. Everything, I mean, was destroyed.
I found the writings of Mariano Payeras, and he was the last Spanish president of the missions. But this letter was, I call it the smoking gun, because it's so important. And Payeras was very frank, did not hold anything back. In his letter, he said, "All we have done for the Indians and is to baptize them, administer the sacraments, and bury them." Says, "We have wiped out the Indians." Well, that's a paraphrase, but that's what he said. And then he said, again, paraphrasing, he said, in fact, it was a letter to his superior in Mexico City, and he wrote, "We have to come up with an alibi that will defend us, because if not, because of the disappearance of all the Indians, he said, if we don't, we're going to get blamed for it, and we're going to be subjected to scandal and scorn.
That is when the big lie of California's Indians' history started. So what they, you know, the story that they created to explain what happened in California is that the Indians came to the missions voluntarily, that they came to find a better life, that they came to learn agriculture, that they came to find God, and many other such reasons as that of why they came to the, why Indians went to the missions. And when you look at the missions today, the history of the California Indians is not told there. As a matter of fact, it doesn't say that 19,421 Indians died at Mission San Juan Bautista. When you go to Santa Cruz, it says nothing that life expectancy for the California Indians there was less than 2 years. All it wants to glorify is the architecture and how holy they are, etc. When I go to the California missions, all I feel is death. I very seldom go to missions because all I feel there is death.
One indication of how a society values its members is how people are memorialized in death. The clear division between the value of priest when compared to the value placed on the lives of Indians is visible in most mission cemeteries. The burial places of priests and church leaders were marked with notable symbols, crosses, and memorials. On the other hand, the deaths of the Indians who built the missions and for whom those institutions were supposedly established were marked with nothing. The final resting place for 2,000 to 4,000 Indians at each mission was a mass unmarked grave.
The fact that Indian people were dumped into unmarked graves at the missions tells me that they were a commodity. They were like a piece of machinery. They were worthless. They didn't have a soul. They had no purpose other than to do their job, and that was it. They weren't respected. They weren't seen as being human beings.
What part do the bell markers along Highway 101 play in the hoax?
There was no El Camino Real during that period. There were trails that led to each mission. It's ridiculous. There is no proof that what is now identified as El Camino ever existed. These people are going, using what the land developers in the late 19th century used to con, to tell people, come to California and enjoy the wonderful crops and the scenery and the ocean and this wonderful weather. Come to California.
Several people traveling through California during the mission period and shortly afterwards wrote of their travels, and not one of them mentions the existence of such a road. Of course, a simple look at a California map dispels the notion that there's a one-day journey or 30 miles between the missions. The distance between San Juan Capistrano and its nearest neighbor to the north is 57 miles. From Mission San Fernando to San Buenaventura is 61 miles, but it's only 18 miles from Mission Santa Ynez to its neighbor, La Purisima. And a check of Spanish mission records reveals the true sequence of their establishment. The first was San Diego in 1769. Then came the Mission Carmel, hundreds of miles to the north, followed by Mission San Antonio. The fourth one was San Gabriel, down in Southern California, and next came San Luis Obispo, and so on and so forth. These are minor parts of the myth, to be sure, but each part contributed to the undeserved praise of the ingenuity of Father Serra and glorification of the mission system. The El Camino myth had its beginning in Los Angeles with a group of wealthy urbanites who owned automobiles and wanted better roads. One of the formative leaders of the group was a woman named Mrs. A.S.C. Forbes, whose husband happened to own the only Bell manufacturing company in the state. Another man named Charles Loomis had already spent a decade promoting the idea of restoring the ruins that used to be missions because of their supposed historical significance, combining a desire for better roads for the few who could afford cars with a desire to create a romantic history, birthed the idea of restoring a road that never existed. Uniting those efforts was the campaign to erect Mission Bell markers along that byway. By the year 1910, the mission myth was thoroughly entrenched in the California mindset. So it was easy to convince the state legislature to fund the state's first highway, Highway 101, as the restoration for this glorious yet fictional feat of Spanish missionary engineering. What is one to take away from all this? First, we must acknowledge our true history. Even school children in Germany learn of the horrors of the Holocaust, so something like that can never happen again. Second, we need to realize that California's historic missions were more like concentration camps or slave plantations than they're like Christian missions you think of today. No one is blaming the mission staff or the people of the church today for what went on in the past. And finally, if you visit one of the missions, remember what kind of institution it was originally. Challenge teachers, history books, educational films, and mission tour guides when they repeat the hoax and espouse the myth.
What I ask of all people, native and non-native, is that they insist that the true history of California be told. Don't allow that history that was told in our schools, the history that was told by state parks, by markers, by the Catholic Church, that false history, don't allow that to continue. Insist that the true history be told.